Dr. Arenberg, if you could please come back up here, if we could just give a warm welcome to Dr. Arenberg and his beautiful bride. For those of you who have been before, we had a little bit of problems with sound. We got a podium that has a built-in speaker, and we gave him a lapel mic this time.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Good?
Yeah, great.
So I don't have to talk really loud?
No, talk loud. Yes, you talk loud.
Yeah, all right. I'm getting the okay from the peanut gallery in the back there. Well, thank you all very much for coming. And Vincent and I welcome you, and thank you all for coming today. And thanks to the wonderful staff here. They've done a great job. And it is fun. And thanks to Bart for providing these snacks. We'll get started. So today we're going to talk about Love and Murder, the final days of Vincent van Gogh. This is the second book in the Killing Vincent trilogy. And it is sort of in press and should be out this month. The third book, I'm working on, and that hopefully will be next year. And in between all that, we have a movie in pre-production called Finally Love. And the pilot script is written and the Bible for that movie, and it's being tossed around in L.A., slowed down by COVID, but I think we're back on track with that. So, Vincent would be happy to see so many of you here, and to seek the truth about his mysterious death. It was a murder, not suicide, and an honor killing. For those of you that weren't here at the previous talks, I'm going to spend a little time in the beginning kind of bringing you up to speed. But the new book, Love and Murder, will have much of that information, and you'll get to decide what you think. So if you want to keep in touch with us at the Killing Vincent Project and progress on the next book and the movies and all that kind of stuff, please sign into the clipboard sign-up sheet to give us whatever information you want so we can be in touch with you. Your response, of course, will be greatly appreciated, and we want to maintain the enthusiasm you have for all those, I would say half of you, have been to something else already here, which I thank you. It's very nice. So this is Love and Murder, is a romantic crime art history drama. It's the ongoing untold story of Vincent's illicit and shocking love affair with his doctor's daughter, and the murder and cover-up as a suicide. And that led directly to the greatest art heist ever, and the successful forgery ring created from his stolen art by the doctor that treated and killed him. Now in that one little paragraph or one on sentence, there's three books and a movie. So what really happened? There you have Vincent. We have a body. Now, if you're a crime person, a criminologist, what really happened? And what really happened on that hot and muggy day in July 1890 that changed art history forever? Was it a suicide or a murder? You go there and you see a body. Your first thing was, is it a suicide or a murder? Until you do the examination. So that's been a big question. The suicide is a cover-up for the murder. This was made by the murderers back in the day, and it was very effective. It really wasn't uncovered until, starting to unravel until the 1950s, 1960s. So now the book, Killing Vincent, The Man, the Myth, and the Murder, has been out for a couple years. And that book is a source book. A lot of research, a lot of references, and it was primarily to prove forensically that Vincent did not shoot himself in the belly, of all places, to commit suicide. He was murdered, a okay? And that's covered in book one, and we covered that in a lot of detail in the past. I'm just going to touch on it a little bit for you. But in the Killing Vincent Project, we've made a lot of accomplishments over several years now. We've made peer-reviewed publications in major medical journals to establish a better understanding of the life, the loves, and the murder of Vincent van Gogh. Number one, Vincent did not have epilepsy. That's what he was diagnosed with in the 1880s. And his attacks were actually an inner ear vertigo, Meniere's disease. That just happened to be my expertise when I was an ear surgeon back in the day. And that was published in JAMA. I'll show you that a little bit later. Number two, Vincent did not commit suicide. That's what we've been talking about. As his false narrative, as a suicide, as a martyr for his art, would have you believe. He was murdered. It was an honor killing. And it was covered up. And it was a magnificent cover up because everybody bought it for years. It was for family considerations in Victorian times that Vincent was involved with the doctor's daughter was not socially acceptable to the Gachets and to Theo's wife, Johanna. Number three, Vincent did not have a suicidal profile by modern criteria, which further goes against him committing suicide and destroyed the cover-up. The suicidal profile analysis was done using modern criteria, all the different things that psychologists and psychiatrists use, and we proved that he was not suicidal in the last months of his life. And then the last contribution was Vincent was not really crazy or insane, as many people claim, but he had Asperger's syndrome, a form of autism, autism spectrum disorder, that would explain some of his strange behaviors. Now, just as an aside, Elon Musk also has Asperger's. So to point out some of his details, here's the letter, you know, one of the letters in Vincent's handwriting, where you can see he wrote "Love or Teach," okay, in that's vertigo in French, and that's the clinical hallmark of classical Meniere's disease. And I went on and proved, taking the history from Vincent from his letters, that he in fact fit all the criteria for Meniere's disease, and that was published in JAMA. On the 100th anniversary of his death. And it was a special communication, as you see here, and that he had Meniere's. Now, if you bear with me and hope that this works, this was 1990, so 32 years ago.
Portraits show Van Gogh with one ear, reminding us that he, along the way, cut off the other one. But his doctor's diagnosis that he was mad may have been way off the mark, and it might have been something far different from madness that drove the great painter to such an extreme act. The principal author of the new report is Dr. I. Kaufman Arenberg. He's an otologist from the Colorado Neurological.
32 years ago.
And the Swedish Medical Center in Denver. Dr. Arenberg is with us this morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
What prompted you? Study Van Gogh's letters in the first
place. Well, I started in undergraduate school. I took an art course, and I read his letters back then. One of my best friend's mothers in high school had Meniere's disease, so I was familiar with the symptoms. And it was obvious that he had Meniere's to me. I didn't do much with it until 1980, and one of my patients who required surgery had failed medical treatment was an artist, and I told her prior to her surgery that she was luckier than Van Gogh because we may be able to help her, but there was no help for Van Gogh's Meniere's disease, and she didn't know anything about that, so she started reading the letters, brought them back, and we decided that we should set the record straight that he really had Meniere's disease and not epilepsy, and he wasn't mad.
So what from the letters led you to believe that it was in fact Meniere's?
Well, Van Gogh is very articulate, and he wrote voluminously to his friends and family. And in these letters, he described his medical illness. And in making the diagnosis of Meniere's disease, the history is very important. important, and he has all of the important features of Meniere's disease.
Explain to us what those are, and we can actually take a look at what the inner ear looks like here.
Well, Meniere's disease is a disease of the inner ear, and this is the hearing part of the inner ear, and these are the balance canals, and they're connected by inner ear fluid. And in Meniere's disease, the patient has attacks of vertigo and dizziness, and these can be associated with nausea and vomiting. They also have a sense of fullness or pressure in the inner ear, and they experience tinnitus or ear noises, a ringing or buzzing type noise. Also, in the early stages of the disease, they have a hearing loss, which fluctuates and can't go back to normal. As the disease progresses and they have more attacks of vertigo, they tend to have a more permanent form of hearing loss.
In his letters, did he try to self-diagnose what he had?
Well, he was very concerned about the problem that he had, and he wanted to have a better understanding of it. He was aware that the inner ear may be involved, and this was pretty perceptive in the 1880s.
How do you treat it?
How do we treat Meniere's? Most patients, approximately 80%, can be successfully managed on medical treatment of low-salt diet, diuretics with potassium supplementation, mild vestibular suppressants, if they're over 60, vasodilators, and we ask them to avoid caffeine, alcohol, tobacco, and stress.
So you say the condition can be managed. Does that mean there is no cure?
There is no cure for the problem. There's a lot of different causes for the buildup of fluid in the inner ear. Now this is the inner ear that we just showed as opposed to the middle ear. And the inner ear normally has fluid just like the eye has fluid. When the intraocular pressure goes up in the eye, the vision goes down, and that's basically what glaucoma is. If the inner ear fluid pressure goes up, it can cause balance problems. If it goes up rapidly and ruptures membranes inside the inner ear, that causes the acute violent attacks of vertigo and the associated hearing loss.
Dr. Arenberg, thanks for giving us a new insight into Van Gogh's history.
Okay.
13 minutes before the...
Well, that was Paula Zahn, in case you didn't know, CBS This Morning. So, anyway, book one, been out for a couple of years, proved forensically that Vincent was murdered. Am I still on?
Yes.
So he didn't shoot himself. Therefore, whoever put the bullet in his belly killed him. And so we published this, a reevaluation of the death of Van Gogh, in the most prestigious forensic medical journal. And my co-authors Dr. DeMaio is the world expert on gunshot wounds and has written the third edition of gunshot wounds, and been testified as an expert in many cases. And Michael Botten, you probably know, and he's coming back into the news now. He was very famous in New York. He was an examiner for the city of New York and involved in many cases, including OJ, et cetera, et cetera. But most recently, he's the one you see on TV saying that Jeffrey Epstein didn't commit suicide, he was murdered, and that's now recycling. So I had very good backup on the article, and so far no one has challenged it. But the problem is, and we'll talk about this, the art community, the art historians and curators and museums are not happy because this kind of distorts the story they've been telling for 100 years, and I'm not on their most favored list. But let's go to the facts. You know, the old saying, just the facts, man, just the facts. There was no suicide note. There was no focus. There was no planning, and no expressed suicide intent. His letters and his art do not suggest a definite plan to commit suicide. Are there any facts or evidence to support this? No. Would any 21st century homicide detective write this case off as a suicide? No. And in the book, I have letters from homicide detectives from Denver and from Denver and from Chicago. Anyway, they would say, no, it's ridiculous. So using today's criteria, we just published this article for a positive suicide profile. It was recently determined by the Killing Vincent team using modern suicide risk criteria that Vincent wasn't even remotely suicidal. So if they looked at all of his evidence and he wasn't suicidal, saying he was suicidal was obviously a great cover-up. So it was murder. It wasn't suicide. The Killing Vincent Van Gogh is the art world's biggest cold case homicide and brilliant cover-up for an honor killing. Now, we also published an article and showed that Vincent was not mad, crazy, or insane, as many people tried to claim, because he was a little bit strange and had some unusual behavior, but he had Asperger's syndrome. So you can't tell that to Elon Musk either, that he's crazy. So multi-billionaire match. So anyway, we wrote this article, Autism. We added autism to the behavioral profile of Vincent Van Gogh. So we've tried to make a lot of contributions to understanding Vincent much better. So the second book, which is coming out this month, and will be here at Atticus Books and Amazon and Barnes & Noble and wherever, hopefully this month. Now that it's February, I can say this month. I'm not holding my breath till I have a book in my hand, but that's the expectation. So this new book is called Love and Murder and focuses on the last days of Vincent Van Gogh. And what it does is explains why Vincent was murdered as an honor killing. We know that he was murdered in the previous work. Now the question is, why was he murdered? So let's explore how the emotions and the why in greater detail. Oh, another movie. screen going to view. Full screen.
For the slideshow.
Couple ways.
Okay, square.
This one?
This, yeah, no, left. Yeah, yes. One, two, three to the right. Perfect.
No?
No, you have to go to slideshow.
This is.
No, it's good.
Yeah, hit the reverse, hit the back arrow. Hit the back arrow.
Upper left, back arrow.
Oh, yeah.
This one?
No, way over, way left. Into the G, the right arrow.
I don't think so.
Well, it was up there before. Yeah, do that.
Does anyone know how to fix this?
Pushing up buttons, you get lucky. Sorry for that. Hang on, we'll catch up real quick. I think that is pretty, covers a lot of territory. So, was this a love worth dying for? Important question. What really happened on July 27, 1890? What, where, when, who, how, but most importantly, why? This is a 19th century cover-up of an alleged suicide, a story that was in fact a homicide, honor killing. It was a false narrative, but it was done brilliantly, and people bought it for years. So maintaining the false narrative is critical at all points to many people in the art community, and the biggest concern of the academic elite, as you can tell, probably not my favorite people, to avoid explaining an honor killing. They don't want to explain it. They don't have to put that in the bookshelves. They don't want to try and take down 100 years of Vincent murdered himself for his art, committed suicide. So a suicide as a martyr for his art is the only acceptable legend and honorable death for Vincent. Truth and reality be damned. Protecting the false and now disproven story must be preserved at all costs. Now, to take this to a younger generation of people, hopefully you will appreciate the humor here. It's short. Little rebel theorist. Thank you. Killing Vincent website. It's under development, it's still getting worked on, but it's a work in progress. Now, I have to go back here. And I have to go forward. There we go. So what really happened? This is where it starts to get interesting. Really want to know what happened. First, let's deal with the facts. These facts that I'm going to present you only raise questions of foul play, murder, and a cover-up. There was no definite crime scene. Think about your CSI type stuff. There was no witnesses. No one heard a gunshot. No one saw him walking back to the Ravuyan from wherever he was mortally injured. No weapon was found at the time. There's no bullet in evidence. No doctor or police report survived, if they ever existed, and no autopsy was performed. There's no contemporaneous description of his entry wound. Can you imagine CSI trying to make that into a suicide? So we're going to connect the dots, and this is where we're going back a little bit for those that weren't here before. We're going to cover in detail the unmasking of three neglected peasant girl portraits that Vincent painted in 3 days, 1 month before he was murdered. Three paintings. This led to these paintings, when they were uncovered or unmasked, who was actually painted, opened the door for the greatest art heist ever after he was murdered. The rise of the infamous criminal Gachet forgery ring was a direct outcome of the murder of Vincent van Gogh and the theft of 26 van Gogh paintings. Today, priceless, priceless, but would fetch billions if on the open market. Number three, it was a 19th century brilliant cover-up using the false suicide narrative of a poor, unknown artist. And then there was an exoneration by Marguerite donating Vincent's art to the Louvre in 1949 to save his art for the world to enjoy. The untold story, and this is pretty cool, the untold story of Marguerite Clementine Gachet and her then unknown lover and artist, Vincent van Gogh, and their bastard son, Vincent Wilhelm van Gogh III. New information most of you, I think. Anyway, this is all going to be in the next book. So who did it? Who do you think did it? Give me an answer.
The doctor.
You got it. The doctor and his son, Team Gachet, as I call them, are the persons of interest. So that's the doctor, that's his son, and here's a picture I saw in 1990. When I was contemplating the role of Dr. Gachet in the life and death of Vincent, and this was at the time of that CBS interview, I never believed that Vincent committed suicide. But at the time, Gachet was only a person of interest, not a homicide suspect. So this is the details on Dr. Gachet, and we'll go over a lot of the people in the story. There's a lot of information, but here's a possible confession. Paul Jr., the son, made this painting in 1904. He thought he was a painter, and he made this painting, and on the back of it, he wrote, "This is the place where Van Gogh committed suicide." It may have been his attempt to cover up or feel better. You know, this is where Van Gogh died. I was there. So this is a crime, the art world's biggest cold case, homicide. So why did this happen? This is an uncensored account of his murder after Vincent left the asylum on his own volition. He's got 70 days to live. So as we've already mentioned, if it was not possible for Vincent to self-inflict his mortal wound, whoever put a penetrating wound in his belly killed him. So why murder Vincent? This is the title information for the movie, Finally Love, The Underkilling of Vincent. And N3M is a production company that has the rights to the movie and the books. So we're going to cover The Honor Killing of Vincent, but also the tragic and very lonely, sad life of Marguerite. The screenplay pilot is written, as is the Bible. And it's being shot in New York, Hollywood, Denver, and now Phoenix, if you want. So the cast of characters involved, these are the main characters. There's Vincent. There's Marguerite. There's Madame Louise Chevalier, and that was the woman who took care of Dr. Bechet, was his mistress, but also supposedly the, she was the mistress. But she was really taking care of and replacing Marguerite's mother after she died. This is Louise Josephine, the illegitimate child of Louise and the doctor. But she was forced to live in the house without any awareness of the people in the village. But she became Marguerite's best buddy. Now, Adeline was just the teenage daughter of the owner of the inn, but she was there for the entire 70 days that Vincent lived. She saw him all the time, she fed him, she repaired his clothes, brought his mail, and she is in the house and what witnessed his last 3 days, his last 30 hours. She's the only eye and ear witness to Vincent's final death. And she was came forward in the 1950s when MGM was making the movie Lust for Life, big blockbuster. She was there, and MGM requested that anybody that knew Vincent, they put ads in the newspaper to come forward. They wanted as much detail as they could to make the movie accurate. And Adeline came forward and told the story that really put the hook into the cachets. She had no reason not to tell the truth, but she was there. And she's the one who told us in her writings that the father came and took several of the paintings because he thought that Van Gogh had compromised his daughter. And back in the day, that was legal for her. She wasn't a virgin anymore. But that's the word was used, compromise. Blanche DeRusse was one of the people brought in into the Gachet forgery ring. And here, as a result of Vincent being murdered, and they took 26 Van Goghs. Remember, he's an unknown artist at this point. Nobody knew these paintings existed. So this, collection of art that nobody knew existed was under the control of these bad people who wanted to make forgeries and fakes and sell them, which they did for almost 60 years. So where did this happen? Well, this is the setting for Auvers in the time. And this is the map. All these death crosses could be any place that Vincent was murdered, including his many wheat fields. But I think that the place that he was murdered is this blue death cross on a barn on the Rue Boucher. And that's, I think, what was painted by the son. So how did he get murdered? Well, what's happening here? We have Marguerite, Vincent, Dr. Gachet, and Junior. Is this an honor killing in the making? The storyboard you're about to see is what the movie people have available. The facts are suggested by the interview with Adeline Rabou in the 50s. and critically important facts supplied by the art historian and Van Gogh expert. That verified that critically, Dr. Gachet, Paul Jr., Marguerite, and Vincent all met together at the Gachet estate on the afternoon of Vincent's shooting. So what was the agenda? This was a pretty unique, tumultuous meeting of the three Gachets. It was fateful, and this meeting was planned by Vincent and Marguerite. Was primarily to request permission from the male Gachets for their acceptance and blessing to support their desire to marry. Well, you can imagine how this went. But the meeting would explain why Vincent did not take any of his art equipment with him on that happy and momentous day. At least he thought it was going to be happy. Obviously, there could not exist a final painting by Vincent's hand absent his equipment on that day. Now, most importantly, when he went there, painting was not on Vincent's agenda for that Sunday, but neither was being murdered. The storyboard, this is what the movie people will use. So here you have...
Hang on.
No, it's our IT guy fixing it for you.
Oh.
There you go.
Nope. All right, so thank you. So Vincent, basically Vincent and Marguerite are there, Shays, and they say, hey, we're in love, we want to get married. Response from Dr. Shay and Paul was dismay and anger, they weren't happy. All the artwork was done by a local artist in Denver named Daryl Anderson. So, after the very negative response, Paul Jr. consoles his father as Marguerite is saddened and looks to Vincent for help. Like, oops, what are we going to do now? They had thought about, and their friends had suggested, just run away. So, in the background here is LJ, Louise Josephine, the second sister, the illegitimate sister of Dr. Gachet. So here the two lovers are going to exit down by the gate, and the doctor and the son are talking, but LJ hears about it. So, they're talking about the final solution to the Vincent problem is planned, but overheard by the housekeeper, Louise Josephine. She's the key fly on the wall to pretty much everything that happened in that house. And that you'll hear a lot more about in book three. So anyway, Louise Josephine rushes to follow her sister to warn Vincent not to go to the barn meeting. At the gates, the two lovers bid adieu, not knowing that their destiny would make this their last embrace. The Overhood plan is shared by Louise Josephine with Marguerite, who encourages her to go to the barn and try to warn Vincent. Over here on the floor is a Guggenheim nude sitting on the floor, still in frame. This was something that was a bone of contention in some of the discussions. And you also see the open drawer where Dr. Gachet allegedly kept his service pistol from the Franco-Prussian War. So now we proceed to the barnyard. Obviously, Marguerite was a little behind. And this is the final argument of the day Vincent was mortally injured. Unfortunately for all of us, Marguerite arrived too late to prevent Vincent from engaging in this ill-fated meeting. She watches in great fear and trepidation as the heated discussion begins. As the argument escalates and Paul Jr. was provoked, He pulls the old service revolver from his pocket. No panic. That is the same revolver. This is real. This is what we used in the forensic testing and everything. And you can see this is a piddly little gun. Okay? But that this is allegedly the same weapon that was used, not this one, but the same model was what was used to shoot Vincent. Anyway, he pulls the old service revolver from his pocket. Vincent says, "Oh, whoa, this is not good." Vincent rushes toward him. He's back down to the ground, and Marguerite is a little bit too late. Paul fires the gun, lethal shot, into Vincent from near the ground. This is what the forensics and the trajectory show. Upward into his belly as Marguerite rushes to the side of her lover. She rushes, but it was a little bit too late. So she's sobbing uncontrollably over Vincent's body as her brother, holding the smoking gun, you can see here, and her father look on with some degree of satisfaction. The Gachets carry a distraught Marguerite, one with each arm, inconsolably sobbing away from Vincent's body. They bring her toward a stool to essentially read her the riot act about how his family honor will be preserved at all costs and to review the official story as it will be told. No one is ever to hear about the truth of what actually happened in that barn or how Vincent really was murdered to preserve her pure image and honor in their small village. As Paul Jr. points the gun at his sister, in a lovingly way, of course, they threaten her to forever maintain her silence about this honor-killing event that was done in her, quote, best interest, or she'll die as well. He was really a bad guy, as you'll see as this evolves. So the sad story now about Marguerite, because, well, after witnessing the murder of her lover and expected husband, Marguerite becomes almost an absolute recluse and a mute, only brightening up at the mention of Vincent's name when she noted that over the years his fame was ascending. And interestingly, she took yellow flowers to his grave every day. So there is Marguerite at the piano, a very famous painting. And here are three paintings we're going to talk about in detail. And I'll prime you with a little bit saying that these are supposedly portraits of a peasant woman. And these three paintings were done within 1 week, 1 month before Vincent was killed. So we're going to go into that in a lot more detail. So when they were unmasked as to who they really were, that was probably the trigger, the catalyst. So this is the world of Marguerite. This is the Van Gogh home from several views, and this was her room. She was trapped and isolated. She was stuck in her only home as her father's servant to remain silent and do all his bidding, as she was not to see or meet any potential suitor for marriage. She was doomed to a prison-like servitude, a recluse and a certain spinster. She was trapped in this very dysfunctional home, along with her father's mistress, Louise Chevalier, who ran the house with an iron fist. Also stuck with her, an even worse predicament, was her illegitimate half-sister, Louise Josephine. Fortunately, LJ, infamous fly on the wall, was her close confidant and friend, as they had bonded in their mutual isolation. So this is Marguerite in old age, older, and she pretty much lived as a spinster, and was never to speak of her relationship with Vincent again. The last tangible Vincent memorabilia was this painting of her at the piano, and this was hung above her bed. for a long time. But here, just to show you what a nice guy her brother was, she was forced to give that painting up in 1934 to a German auction house by her evil brother. It was a show of force to continue controlling her in her silence. And that was the last actual thing that she retained from Vincent. Now, I'm giving a special thanks and kudos to Allison Richmond for a touching novel and diligent research called The Last Van Gogh, 2006. It's a very good book, and she did some interesting research. She uncovered the sad story of this German auction and that history of that painting, and discovered and confirmed the existence of Louise Josephine. And that's very important in book three. So this was really her sad story for the rest of her boring and tedious life, or so it seemed. In 1890 France, women, particularly unmarried women, had no rights, no legal resources, no vote. She was pretty trapped, except for a little Vincent surprise. That's book three. She spent the rest of her life saving Vincent's art for